Okay, welcome everyone. This is a tour of my layout. I'm Byrne Blumenstein, and my layout is the Santa Fe layout, which I refer to as the Eagle West Division of Santa Fe. And it is designed to do a selectively compressed version of the Santa Fe Railway running from Barstow in California to Chicago Corworth Yard, which is what you see behind me here, as well as Santa Fe Super Chief Service coming out of Chicago California to Chicago from Union Station in Los Angeles to Union Station, Dearborn Station in Chicago. So you get kind of a flavor of a transcontinental where it runs clear across the desert southwest, through the mountains, and you see some of that as we get close up, and then into the Chicago area. And then it connects, my layout connects with the Pennsylvania Railway, and so for passenger service, we actually were able to interchange cars from the Santa Fe Super Chief during an operating session and cut cars out of the Super Chief into the Broadway Limited or from the Broadway Limited back in. So an operational piece that's different in my layout is I'm actually interchanging passenger service, not just freight service between railroads. So that's kind of a sense of it, and I've been building it for about 9 years. And there are several things that we'll give you a little bit of a tour on that are unique below the bench level that I think folks seeing this will learn some things that may be helpful to their own design layouts. So enjoy the tour, and we'll do a couple of close-ups here so you get a little better view of some of the detail and some of the electronics and benchwork here. So thanks for taking a look at the tour. We can roll that one forward. And you'll notice it snakes across the desert. It's just going a straight line. And interesting enough, when Norm Logan painted the backgrounds, he painted barbed wire, of course, coming across the desert. And right in front of it, you'll see there's barbed wire that I've actually built onto the desert surface to kind of continue what's there from the background to make it kind of interesting. And this is all double track mainline heading into the mountainous areas, so why don't we do a kind of close-up from there. And it's heading into a helix, double track helix, that brings the traffic from the upper level down to the lower level. So, yeah. And you'll notice the cab lights are set so that once it starts moving, the cab lights go off, and it stops, the cab lights go back on. But I've turned off most of the lighting and the sound just simply because it becomes more than a little distracting when you're on camera. As it picks up speed, and again it's heading across the desert. If you look closely, you'll actually see there's some deer alongside the track that we're going past on the other side. And now it's coming up on Mining Town here. Yes. And that's an old section from someone else's layout that was able to integrate into mine, and it just fit perfectly, literally, between the benchwork and the ceiling. It fit to within like a quarter of an inch. It was just perfect. And it's just so beautiful to get rid of. You know, one of the things I'm glad we got to do is preserve things from older layouts that just are such gorgeous landscaping and detail. So, do that. And we'll get you a close-up here of that little town. Give you kind of a sense of what's out there. A lot of detail. Right down to the phone poles as well. And the moss coming off the side. One of the things I've shown a lot of people that they found interesting in the way I've designed the layout is that I don't use suitcase connectors for my wiring, and I don't use wraparounds for the drops that come off the individual tracks. What I've basically decided to do and I've learned to do is everything runs off of the bus bar. So I'll bring in the two leads from the main bus, and then each individual pair comes to a screw terminal here on the bus, and these connect vertically. These are not bus strips. This is a bus bar. So everything from this screw powers all of these. Everything from that screw powers all of these. If I have a problem with any piece of track, whether it's a short, I can simply unscrew the two screws for that one piece. I don't have to mess up with soldering. I don't have to unwire anything, wrap anything. I don't have to cut out a suitcase connector. It's as simple as popping two screws. So that gives me much better, greater control. The other thing that I've done here is the underside of the layout has absolutely no wiring running through the framework. It is entirely held, all the wires are held in place by a series of Velcro strips, these. So by using Velcro, if I have to remove a piece of wire, I can simply open the Velcro, drop that one piece of wire, Velcro back up. I don't have to pull the wire back any place. Basically, I can just drop the wire real simply. It takes a whole lot less time. Or if I'm putting in fresh wiring, I just run the wiring through the Velcro loop. So I found the combination of doing those two things, as well as having plenty of electric outlet strips all over the layout, makes it a whole lot easier to get things done and fix things as well as install things. And of course, by using these, I'm able to put all of my electronics for the turnouts, for the frog juicers, in batches, and I use 6-unit frog juices for all of my paranormal frogs. So all of my frogs are live, so that makes it a little easier. And again, they're shorter runs to connect two of them to on the bus. I just use different color coding for those. So that kind of gives you an explanation of the way I've designed the underside of that by using bus bars. Big time saver for me. So hopefully that helps you when you're designing your layouts. Somebody at Broadway Limited has a really bizarre sense of humor, so when I trigger cab chatter, what I'm hearing is somebody's cab chatter listening to a video of the movie Spaceballs. So, really interesting. And I've got some other things that have sound, obviously, that are unusual. The stock car by the stockyards over there is from Broadway Limited, and so when you turn on power or when you move the car, you'll actually hear sheep moving around in the car and buying. And you'll actually hear, in some cases, them running back and forth from one end of the car to the other. So, kind of a neat thing to add sound to that, to do some unusual things. Talking about sound, we can jump to the other side of the layout and I'll show you something like the subway cars. There we go. Okay, that's to function.
Okay. Next stop, Woodlawn, Jerome Avenue.
Now, I rode that subway train every day going from high school, from the Bedford Park stop in the Bronx in New York, to Burnside Avenue. So what I get to hear all the time is when I hit it.
Next stop, Bedford Park Boulevard.
And that's the exact announcement I heard growing up in high school. And then.
Next stop, Burnside Avenue.
That's the actual announcements that I got to hear. Now, you know what's really bizarre about what you're hearing? They're done with a Bronx accent,
yeah,
which is really a neat touch to it. So now, on the other side, and these obviously are not where they're going to run. There will be subway lines running across underneath here under Penn Station. But let me flip over to this one, which is 7053. So it's to Loco. This one will give me the announcements for the Broadway line. And one of the stops on the Broadway line was the conductor announcing, we're now entering 34th Street, Penn Station, 34th Street. So that the actual announcement that you hear coming out of the subway, when my trains come into Penn Station. So that's an additional stage. So, I'm not sure where it's going to take me, but that's okay. dressed version of the Conrad Hilton in Chicago, and this one in Chicago. What's interesting is there's a pool up there in that one, and occasionally the pool in Chicago on top of the buildings was the site of Playboy fashion shoots. So one of the things I've bought for that pool is a powered photographer, which has a little LED in it, so when you hit a button, the flash goes off and he's taking a picture of whoever's at whatever outfit, or lack of outfit, in the pool on top of the Conrad Hilton in Chicago. So another little bit of fun detail touch. And of course, you can't have a high-rise building in Chicago or New York without having King Kong climbing it from the movies. What's interesting is that particular building, when I picked it up, was the rare case of someone doing a kitbash. But most kitbashes are buildings next to each other being butted together. This is a case where somebody kitbashed two buildings on top of each other to get the height. And it was almost the perfect height to just about get to the ceiling in the room. So it just fit perfectly. And by the way, if you pan up, you'll notice it's easy. I make it easy for people to see what will be inside when I put the streets in place, because I put a mirror on the ceiling. I copied that from Jim Tilley's layout. It makes it easier to see what's going on. Plus, when I'm at the control point, I can see the position of the switch as kind of a double check, so I'm viewing them at a distance from by looking at the ceiling. So that's kind of what that is. And obviously not more accurate like the streets and such. So that's Chicago, right down to the buses and buildings and so on. So I think we found that a little bit interesting. Okay, this particular section of the layout is kind of the crown jewel of solving a problem. In this particular case, I've got three tracks at three different levels. There's a third one that we come across here. You can only see the first two in place. The problem with crossing an aisle at three different levels is you can't do a flip-up because the geometry doesn't work. The upper level abutments would just bang into each other. So I was kind of stuck. How do I get three different levels of track across the aisle and then be able to remove that so that I can actually walk up and down that aisle as we need to? And then one day I was watching a movie with Gene Wilder called Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. And in the movie, at the end of it, Gene Wilder steps into an elevator with a kid, and the kid says, "This is a really neat elevator." And Wonka responds, "It's not an elevator. An elevator only goes up and down. A Wonkavator goes up and down and right and left and forward and back." And I'm listening to that, I'm going, that's exactly what I need to do. I need something that can drop down and then retract out of the way so I can get access to the aisle. So I need to build a Wonkavator. Okay, how exactly does one go about building a Wonkavator? So I worked on that for about a month and a half actually, and found some mechanisms and some ways of doing this. So let me give you an example. I'll put the light down here so you can see it a little bit better. But this whole section of benchwork needs to be able to drop down and get out of my way. So as the expression goes, behold, the world's first Wonkavator on a model railroad layout. And as you can see, it drops almost straight down and then pneumatically retracts out of the way into the benchwork. And there's a buffer on the end of it to stop it smoothly so it doesn't rattle as it comes across. No electronics required, simply push down on it, and away it goes. And in traversal, you just grab one of the knobs, pull it back up, and line up. The real challenge actually was doing some of the alignments. I've got an angle piece there, so I can flip that out of the way, give myself some more room on the layout to operate. But that's basically the world's first model railroad Wonkavator. One of the issues when you have a helix on your layout is it's very difficult to know what's going on in there, how far along the engine has progressed. So what I ended up doing is buying two cheap cameras that cost me about $35, mounted both of them in it, and put a little program on my old tablet. So as you can see here, I've got the ability to look up close as to what is going on in there, and you can see at the very top, there is the Reefer Express coming through at the very top level. And then I can go back and go to a previous screen, and you'll get to see when I pick up the view from the opposite side. And there's a view from the other side of the helix. Again, you can see the cameras in there. Real simple, just plug it into an outlet, little piece of software you put on your tablet, a spare tablet, put that out there, and now I've got the ability not only to see it, but I could walk around, of course, if I need to for some reason or other. So I've got two cameras. I'm able to see basically 360-degree view of what's going on inside the helix. So it's a real cheap way to do it, better than standing around waiting or trying to listen to what is actually going on inside there. So hopefully that's another electronics idea to help you. And by the way, the panel that's below it here is a touchscreen control panel. So when I've got this fully connected, you'll see little lights there, and you don't have to flip a switch. You just simply touch the number on it, and it will turn that outlet to that turnout to whichever position you want to change it to, and it'll change from green to gray. So that's kind of what I'm installing. And the other piece that I'm in the middle of working up is the installation of Iowa's proto-throttle. And this thing is about as close as you can get to the operation of a real control panel on a real diesel. And you can see there's a photo of an SD with the levers, and again, it's got levers pretty much up in the same way. You've got a delivery on the horn, you've got obviously a bell control here, you've got levers that you can put in place that will allow you to move the panels back and forth as necessary, and you can do some programming as well. So it's a pretty neat tool, basically doing the same kind of mechanisms as they built into an SD. So, and the panels come in different colors, so I just bought this one to start with red. So hopefully that's of help. Okay, sometimes you're working on buildings that are going to go in a specific place, but this one I found to be kind of interesting. We all know that there are cases where someone will actually move a building in the real world, just like we do on the layout. So this is a building that is in the process of a building mover moving it right down to the hitch and all of the axles. So that's something that adds a touch that you would never expect to see on the layout, building movers moving a building. So nice little another sense of whimsy that I've plugged into the layout. So anyway, hope you find that kind of interesting. Okay, one of the things that I wanted to do was have a programming track that couldn't possibly be connected to anything else. Well, it turns out the Walther's piers, or pure sections, if you put them together, they're not connected to anything. They'll be going to a building that we'll be sitting over here, but they're not connected to the rest of the layout. They are strictly wired as my programming track. So from my control point here, I can turn around, drop an engine onto that track, and do my programming here without in any way having any interruption with any of the other trackers that's on the layout. So it's kind of a neat way to get your programming track on the layout without it looking like a programming track, because it's separated out. And while we're on the subject, on the layout, I've got the Walther's tugboat for the barge tug. And that same barge actually appears in my background on the far side here by my Riverside Industrial Yard. If you look over here, you'll actually see the equivalent barge in the photograph in the background as part of the background next to the launch. So I have both the 3D version of the tug and the photographic background version of the tug to give it sort of three-dimensional feel to what we're doing here. So that's kind of another interesting touch there. This wall was an interesting project. Lots of people have photos of their Jeeps, Santa Fe Jeeps with the Santa Fe lettering. We've seen a million of those. But what I decided to do here is literally build and set up the wall so it literally looks like the side of a Jeep in my crew lounge. Interesting too that the lettering, I had originally contacted a company called Fathead that does these football player appliques that kids put on their walls that are 3 or 4 feet high, and they wanted around $100 for each letter. My son said, well, he knows the guys who do a lot of the restaurant window displays, like, for a special this week, for such and such. So he contacted those guys. He downloaded the PMS color scheme for Santa Fe. He then downloaded the type font for Santa Fe, had them produce these letters as a peel and stick. It took us about 2 hours, an hour and a half to put them all up. That entire wall cost me $70 million. So it's a really inexpensive way to decorate your lounge by doing railroad lettering on the wall. Fills the wall, and it's definitely noticeable that it's that Santa Fe colors. It's the real thing. So hopefully you enjoy that one. Okay, this picture is kind of interesting. One of the things, the thing that I finish up with as I do tours of the layout is I point out that everybody knows various different train terms, but one of the terms that everyone knows, if they've got kids, is that they have to potty train their kids. And the question I'll ask people as I finish up is, well, you've used the word potty train before, but have you ever actually seen the potty train? Well, if you haven't, There's a picture of the actual potty train. Steam engine and a whole bunch of porta potties and latrines being towed along behind it on trestle. So now you can tell people you've actually seen the potty train. So that is your tour of the Santa Fe Eagle West Division. I hope you found this interesting today and learned some things that you might want to think about doing on your layout, the electronics, the sound, doing things like recessing the legs 6 inches, 8 inches out so that nobody kicks on them, to use nothing but round corners on your fascia panel so there's nothing to catch on. A lot of little details that people don't necessarily think of because they're thinking just of the trains that are sitting on the surface. But there's a lot of ideas that we share when you get into things like background, the wiring, the legs, the sound, and so on. So hopefully this has been kind of interesting and educational for you, give you some ideas to put into your own layout if you're building a layout, some interesting ideas to consider when you're starting up. So thank you for visiting the Santa Fe Eagle West Division. My name is Byrne Blumenstein. I'm a member of Division 6 NMRA in the Detroit area. And I hope you found this helpful. Thank you much.